the beginning. Each speaker has up to 25 minutes to present his or her thoughts. And we will have short questions if there's a need be after each talk, and an open discussion after the comment by Professor Peter. Our first speaker is Gual Roy, Professor Gual Roy from the University of Haifa, where he's the head of the School of History. He very recently published with Stanford University Press a remarkable volume on Palestine and an Unpromising Land, Jewish Migration to Palestine in the Early 20th Century. He's obviously a well-known specialist for Eastern Europe more generally.
Between 1918 and 1920, there were over 1,000 pogroms in Ukraine, during which some 100,000 Jews were murdered and wounded. These pogroms were instigated against the background of a bloody civil war between the Bolsheviks and their many opponents: the Ukrainian nationalists, Germans and Polish soldiers, the White Army, headed by Anton Denikin, local partisans, and Ukrainian farmers. The warring parties exploited the chaos and governmental anarchy to massacre Jews. Towns were torched, communities were ripped out, Jewish property was looted, and Jews were executed in cruel and unusual ways, while women were raped and humiliated. Tens of thousands of orphans had to be cared by Jewish aid organizations. It was a national disaster, the likes of which had never been known before. One of the characteristics of the pogroms in Ukraine was the mass raping of Jewish women to an unprecedented extent in Jewish society. The pogroms of 1881-1882 were marked by robbery, plunder, and destruction. According to testimonies, women were raped during the pogroms of Kishinev, and there was a continuity of this phenomenon in the pogroms in the south and the southwest of the Pale of Settlements during the year 1904-1906. The historiography dealt with the pogroms in Eastern Europe intensively, but only very few studies examined the anti-Jewish riots from below, the victim's point of view, and from gender perspective. This paper is divided into three parts. The first examined the violence against women in the pogroms of 1903-1906. The second focused on the mass raping of Jewish women during the Civil War. And the third part deal with the reasons for silence in the public discourse of Jewish society regarding rape during the years after the pogroms. However, before I begin, I would like to present you briefly with the primary sources I have used in preparing this lecture. After the Kishinev pogrom, a delegation on behalf of the Historical Committee in Odessa was sent to investigate the incident. The delegation was led by Chaim Nachman Bialik, who was asked to gather evidence from surviving victims and to collect the investigation material required to bring the rioters to justice. At the end of the investigation, Bialik was in possession of photographs and newspaper clipping, broadsheet in Russian, and mainly the testimonies of victims who told him what they had suffered. Those testimonies were published in Hebrew in 1991 or 1992. We also have a few testimonies about rape during the pogroms that occurred between the years 1904-1905, which were published in the contemporary press. On the civil war in Ukraine, we have a lot of evidence, both of women who were raped and of witnesses who told what they had seen and experienced during the pogrom. It is doubtful if historians of our period could have traced the range of rape abuses and its influence on Jewish society without the massacre scroll of Eliezer David Rosenthal, who took upon himself the task of documenting the pogrom. Eliezer David Rosenthal was a teacher in the town of Teplik who was saved from the pogroms and undertook to document what was happening to the Jews during the Civil War. He settled in Odessa and recorded testimonies from the many Jewish refugees who arrived in the city and collected the relevant documents. At the beginning of 1920, he began writing his book, The Massacres called Megillat HaTevach, material concerning the period of the pogroms and the massacre of Jews in the Ukraine, in Great Russia, and in White Russia. The book described plainly and without embellishment the acts of rape, murder, abuse, and plunders in about 400 cities and towns in the Ukraine during the Civil War period. What is common among most of the sources, including Rosenthal, that refer to rape and sexual violence is the laconic tone in which they are reported and that they are merely informative. They usually tell what's happened without comments or public discussions. The pogrom generated fear among the Jewish population and threatened to damage the family unit and to undermine. The acts of murder were accompanied by the sadistic killing of small children and sexual abuse of women. In the absence of law and order, the rioters took advantage of the temporary anarchy in order to attack and abuse them. The gender mindset is discernible in the method of attack against women and men. The examination of the names of 462 murder victims in three pogroms, Kishinev 1903, Odessa 1905, Bialystok 1906, showed that in Kishinev, out of 41 pogrom victims, eight died of their wounds and we don't have their names and age, seven were women, which is 17%. In Odessa, between October 18 to 22, 1905, 303 Jews were killed, among them 28 women, which is about 9%. In Bialystok, at the beginning of June 1906, 110 Jews were killed, 18 of them were women, which means 16%. In the Ukrainian Civil War, about 600,000 Jews were killed, of which 75% were men and 25% were women. Although less women than men were murdered, yet, as we shall see later on, they also suffered sexual abuse and rape. Many women were infected with sexually transmitted diseases and carried the trauma of the pogroms for many long years afterward. Rivka Schiff, 24 years old, was raped during the Kishinev pogrom in April 1903. In her testimony, she told Bialik what she had undergone and about her friend Sima Golda. I quote, "When the dirty fellows broke into the attic by way of the roof, a few of them jumped on the daughter of Zaychik, Sima Golda. At first, they slapped her on the cheek and surrounded her. They then turned her face downwards and her back upwards and began to violate her." Schiff did not spare any details and described to Bialik exactly what had taken place in the house on 11 Nikolai Street. Since I'm short in time, but mainly because some ethical reasons that maybe I will talk about them in the end of the lecture, I will not continue with the Schiff testimonies and other evidences of raping women during the pogrom of 1904-1905, but I have many, many, many of them. The attack of Jews and Jewish women during the Civil War period was a direct continuation of the patterns of violence at the beginning of the 20th century. Yet, in contrast with the rape cases in Kishinev, Odessa, and other cities, the extent of rape in the Ukraine was a scope that Jewish society had never experienced before. As I noted at the beginning of my lecture, one of the important sources for understanding the extensive range of rape cases is the massacre scroll of Eliezer David Rosenthal. Sometimes the references are laconic and sometimes they deal with specific cases in which the rape woman is given in a personal and family name. One example for laconic, and one example for detailed testimony.
This actually the book that published, three volumes that published between 1927 to 1931, but the other volumes never published. I found them in as a manuscript in Archeon Nazim Archive in Tel Aviv. It's about 800 pages in Hebrew with testimonies and other documents about Paul. So, laconic example. We youngsters, I quote, we youngsters were put against the wall. 11 were killed. I was the only one who remained alive. In the course of 1 week, 122 people were killed. The number of wounded was very large. Almost all the women and girls found in the settlements were raped. And in the town of Bodovka, after running up to the men and killing them, they raped their wives and daughters. In certain cases, testimonies were much more detailed and specific cases were described. This is how the girl Wilfan, a fatherless orphan, 13 years old, was killed. She fell into the hands of three bandits who dragged her to one of the houses and raped her. Three old women were sitting in the next room and only heard her sobs. The bandits ordered her not to shout or they would end her life. After the rape act, the girl's hair turned white and she died that same day of distress, suffering and grief. She was not the only one. Many died by the hand of their relatives. Besides the raping of women, there is considerable evidence of the abusage and murders of pregnant women. It is not possible to estimate the extent of this phenomenon and to calculate the numbers, but it was mentioned in the contemporary press and in the testimonies gathered from the survivors. For example, in the newspaper Hedazman, a short while after the pogrom in Odessa, it was written that slowly the details of the terrible cruelty that characterized the action of the rioters began to come to light. A hospital orderly related that in Rasovskaya Street, the rioters killed a pregnant woman who was about to give birth. The child's head had just begun to emerge from his mother when the rioters killed both mother and child. In that same war, a midwife was killed and a woman. In a letter to Israel Zandvil, Rabbi Moshe Rosenblatt described a similar situation in Kiev. A shout is heard outside in our city of Kiev. The screams of children and infants, the sound of women fainting, the groans of their dying, and the breaking of the bones of old people thrown from the upper floors deafen the air of Kiev. They are slicing open and stomachs of pregnant women, cutting out organs from healthy people, and flaying them with iron combs. Eliezer ben Yehuda wrote in his newspaper Ashkafa, at the end of Svichana Street in Kishinev, the rioter took pregnant women, set her on a chair, and struck her belly with iron bar. And in the newspaper Hedazman was written, the hooligans killed a poor pregnant woman after sexually abusing her in a very shameful manner and destroy her house. They slit her belly, extracted the child, and threw it outside. From the testimonies that collected, a terrifying picture emerged of raped Jewish women. Yet, from the testimonies that were produced, one cannot learn how the raped women managed to cope with the trauma they had experienced. What was the reaction of the Jewish society to this mass raping? What assistance did they offer to the rape victims? What were the repercussions of such traumatic events on the Jewish society? And why was public discussion is muffled in silence so that there is very little reference to such an important and sensitive issue? Public silence is not only characteristic of the Jewish society. During the 20th century, there were more than a few cases of mass rape by soldiers and conquering armies, and public discussion was pushed aside. In September 1937, according to estimate, Japanese soldiers raped about 20,000 Chinese women in the city of Nanking and its surroundings. During the Second World War and its aftermath, Russian soldiers raped about 1.5 million German women. Women also raped in concentration camps in military bordels that were established to supply sexual needs for the soldiers. In the 1990s, Serbian soldiers raped Bosnian women. And in Rwanda, the Hutus slaughtered, murdered, and raped the Tutsi people. From the historical perspective, and in the continuity of time, the case of Jewish women who were raped during the civil war in Ukraine does not differ from the other rape cases that occurred at the end of the first half of the during the second half of the 20th century. Until the civil war in Yugoslavia, rape was not considered a war crime or crime against humanity during a war period, and it was not discussed in international legal framework. International courts of law that were set up in Nuremberg and Tokyo after the Second World War hardly dealt with sexual violence and rape, and they were not included in charge that were presented against war criminals. The acts of mass rape of Jewish women by Walter had far-reaching social repercussions. The rapists broke down the social structure, damaged the basic fibers of life, and weakened the Jewish community as an organic unity. Violence against women was part of much wider strategy of attacks against Jews beyond there being only a separate ethnic group. The murders, robbed, plundered, burned, and killed, but the damage done to Jews could not be perfect without the violation of the bodies and souls of his wife and daughters. The rape of Jewish women was meant to humiliate, to scorn and shame not only the rape victims, but also intensify the damage and the defeat of Jewish men who saw the rape of their wife and daughters and could not save them. The Jewish woman was a double victim, as a Jew on one hand, and as a woman on the other, whom the writers regarded as a symbol of continuity and fertility, and therefore she had to be attacked in her pregnant belly and womb. Another reason for silence in the public discourse, beyond the shame and disgrace of honor for the Jewish woman, is the halachic problem which results from the rape and the need to resolve it discreetly. The fear of bastardy, unwanted pregnancy, sexual diseases, the breakup of the family unit, the babies who were born in sin. In addition, the woman who is raped is not punished by halacha, and she does not bear any sin. But since the transgression was carried out on her, she is considered of being damaged and is forbidden to marry a Kohen. If she was already married a Kohen, she must part from him. It may be that due to the range of the phenomenon and the high number of women who were raped, that this halachic issue and many others impose difficulties on the community leaders who were required to cope with the halachic and human problems that were created. It was preferable to refrain from wide public discussion and to cope with the human problem without exposure and solve them quietly, far from the watchful eyes of the public. To conclude, Joseph Schechtman, one of the few public figures who noted in one of his articles that mass rape has direful effects on Jewish society. In 1923, he published his article Antisemitism and Poland, in which he dealt both with the extent of the phenomena in which is and with its repercussions. And I quote, "A special place in the riot is held by the women rapists of the volunteer army. In none of the previous riots was there such a large number of women raped and with such a fearsome brutality. There was not a single pogrom in which the rioting volunteers did not defile the daughters of Israel. There are towns in which every woman was raped, from the youngest to the oldest. They raped them in view of the husbands, fathers, and brothers. The question regarding the raped women has become a national and psychological problem, both difficult and painful in the Ukraine. The attitude of Shechtman towards the raping of women during the Civil War was laconic, but his assertion of a national and psychological problem, both difficult and painful, perhaps demonstrates above all else the distress of Jewish community in trying to cope with the social implication of rape, not only during the pogrom period, but also in the years that followed. I believe that the time has come not only to discuss the pogroms itself, but devote a special discussion to the issue of the day after and the degree in which Jewish society was able to rehabilitate itself after a traumatic event such as that of the pogrom." Now, if I have only 1 minute, I need is about ethical dilemmas in my research, because the testimonies are very detailed, and I found myself as a researcher as what I can use and what not in that cases. And I would like to show you how I solved the dilemma. I hope I did it correctly. And I would like to do it by the painting pogrom by the Polish artist Wojciech Weiss, 1875. 1950, which was apparently painted during the years 1918 and 1919. The painting depicts the rape of Jewish women by two soldiers, one holding her arms and others with an evil smile at the corner of his mouth, clasping her legs. Under the windows lying a Jew dressed in the clothes of Hasid, who was just murdered. Wise refrains from describing the details of the rape. The body of the rape victim is almost unexposed. Her legs are bare, and also some of her upper body, but the intimate parts of it are hidden by a section of the wall separating the two windows. Although the painter does not provide the details, the painting still leaves the viewer with a profound and painful impressions. Likewise, I think, or I'm trying, in bringing the testimonies of the raped women to create a screen or section between the quotation and the readers of the article or my research to create a shock at the violence shown towards women, but to refrain from pornographic descriptions. Thank you.
Thank you. In case there are specific questions to Guo, please
let me. Just a comment and a question, maybe a very large question. The comment, first of all, has to do with the Rosenthal database, which you know very well, but there are two other large bodies of testimonies. One, those collected by the Ostjudisches Historisches Archiv, of which Shechtman, whom you mentioned, was a part, and the other by the Kiev Relief Committee. Mm-hmm. And those are available now. The first of those tabulated cases of rape in approximately 220 or 230 locations. And it could be very helpful to you, just as a check on the Rosenthal data, to go through the testimonies from those locations where rapes were noted and tabulated. And there is a tabulation, I can show it to you, and that may be helpful. The question, which is a very large question, is are there any other gendered aspects to the experience of pogroms besides rape that you can talk about? For example, you note a significant difference in the number of male and female victims, and you know changes over time. How can you account for them? Did women engage in strategies anticipating violence that were different from those of men? Was there an assigned or gender-based division of tasks in the face of a pogrom? And can you make any comments besides this one issue of rape that deal with gendered aspects of this?
Yeah, okay, it's a really large to answer or to collect the...
I think this is... I'm not sure whether we should... I mean, perhaps you have a first thought about other aspects of gender dimensions, and we take up the issue certainly in the overall discussion.
Okay. To answer in the discussion...
Briefly, perhaps you have the first thought.
Rape is only a chapter or sub-chapter in my article about gender perspective. Of course, there are others, issues regarding gender perspectives of the pogroms. For example, the pogroms occurred during the mass Jewish migration to the United States. And the Jewish migration occurred in two steps. First, the husbands, and then the women and the children. So there are many women or family that stay behind while the pogrom occurs and what they did while the husband is in the United States and they have to stay with the children alone. So this is, I think, a very interesting question about those women that try to save the family unit without the husband and the correspondence between the husband and his family. I have found many letters of husbands in New York City that apply to Hayas and ask help and information about the family. And in many cases, the answers they got that the woman was murdered, the one of the kids were killed. And so I think this is one aspect of the gender point of view. There are others. I think the fears of the woman, I would say in general, not only the woman, of course, the fathers, but the fears to be a part of the sexual violence. There is a potential to be a victim. And I think it was always in the background of the rape, and we can read it over and over again in all the testimonies and the newspapers. Just the fears, not the rape.
Ukrainian nationalism and anti-Jewish violence in summer 1941 in Eastern Galicia.
My presentation attempts to summarize the results of a larger study that will be published and then probably in July, rather August, on anti-Jewish violence during the first weeks of the German attack on the Soviet Union after the 22nd of June 1941 in the region of Eastern Galicia. These events have been, as you know, highly controversial both in research literature and also in public debate. In the Ukrainian case, the most controversial issue is the role of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, the OUN, and its cooperation with the Germans. But the events of summer 1941 relate also to larger discussions about the relationship of the Soviet regime and its crimes on the one hand and the Holocaust on the other hand, because the violence against Jews was year, especially in Eastern Galicia, preceded by a Soviet massacre of prison inmates. Here and then during the first week of the war after 22nd of June. Here in a number of places in Eastern Galicia, between 7,500 and 10,000 prison inmates were killed after the German had attacked the Soviet Union. My paper has three parts. In the first part tries to present some results from an analysis of German-Ukrainian cooperation until the beginning of the German-Soviet war, in order to explore the question if pogroms were prepared jointly or by one of the sides. The second part of the paper discusses anti-Jewish violence in the city of Lvov and the further development of relations between the OUN and the Germans. The third part presents then some results of a detailed analysis of acts of violence in some 30 cities and towns and rural regions during the first weeks of July 1941. Yes, I come now to the first part. The OUN and its predecessor, the Ukrainian military organization, the UBO, Ukrainska Vyskova Organizatsiya, had cooperated already since the 1920s with the so-called up there, the intelligence section of the German army. After some interruptions since 1934, the Abwehr revived the cooperation in 1938 and during the preparation for the attack on Poland in the spring and summer 1939. After the Soviet occupation of Eastern Poland in September 1939, many Ukrainians, among them many active members of the OUN, fled into the German occupied areas. During the year 1940s, the OUN split. Among the most important reasons was a conflict within the organization about the strategy towards the Soviet-occupied territories of Eastern Poland. While Andriy Melnik, the leader, the then-time leader of the OUN, did not want to start an active struggle with the Soviets in Western Ukraine, but wait for a German-Soviet war that he expected already at that time for the near future, a group of younger OUN activists, led by the then later famous Stepan Bandera, had different views on this issue. That means they wanted to start an active struggle against the Soviets. The consequence was a split, and the consequence for the Melnik leadership of the OUN was rather significant. Practically, it lost the control over the organization in the Polish territories, that means in the Generalgouvernement, the German-occupied part of Poland, and the Soviet-occupied territories, the underground structures in the Soviet territories. Despite many arrests among OUN members after the Soviet occupation of Western Ukraine, the OUN, now led by Stepan Bandera, was able to strengthen its organizational structures under Soviet occupation and to start an active struggle that consisted of assaults on Soviet officials and the preparation of an uprising. On the German side, on the German side of the Abwehr and the different German institutions, there prevailed a strong mistrust against the activist Bandera OUN. Only in spring 1941, the Abwehr, the German military intelligence, intensified the cooperation with the Bandera OUN when the Wehrmacht, the German army, started concrete preparations for the attack on the Soviet Union. The reason was that only the Bandera OUN had good connections into the Soviet territories, were able to provide intelligence from there and to prepare an uprising in support of German troops that should start after the German attack on the Soviet Union. And they were also the group that were really able to raise men for two Ukrainian battalions with the later code names Nachtigall and Roland that were deployed in spring 1941 in order to move with the Wehrmacht into the Soviet territory. The German security police, however, the German police forces cooperated in summer 1941 with the more obedient and docile Melnik faction of the OUN, despite the fact that that part of the OUN had practically no influence in Eastern Galicia. In May and June 1941, the leadership of the Bandera OUN wrote down extensive instructions for the beginning of the German-Soviet war and four steps towards Ukrainian state building after the beginning of that war. They described as the OUN's main aim to install local administrations and militias in localities where the Soviet troops were about to leave as soon as possible and preferable before German troops arrived. This should provide the basis for a Ukrainian state building and demonstrate to the Germans the strength of the Ukrainian will and ability to establish a great Ukrainian national state. Despite repeated efforts, the OUN had not been able to receive from the German side any clear assurances that a Ukrainian state will be founded as a result of the war and as a part of the, and that was basically the basis for their willingness to cooperate with the Germans. One of the tasks that the Bandera OUN assigned to its combat troops and local militias that were formed in the underground and should then be formed in after the beginning of the war in the liberated localities was to cleanse the territory from enemy forces, as they called it, that did not mean only that, on the one hand, that mean remnants of Soviet troops and NKVD officials, but also more generally from supporters of Soviet rule. A number of documents that show that also within the OUN primarily Jews were seen as Soviet supporters, but also the discussions within the OUN at that time before the beginning of the war and also afterwards make clear that with respect to the foundation of a Ukrainian nation state, the Bandera OUN considered Jews to be an undesirable group. The head of the OMB, the Bandera OUN structures in the Soviet territories, Ivan Klimov, interpreted these tasks for the period after the beginning of the German-Soviet war in an especially radical way in two leaflets that he had written already before the beginning of the German attack and that were widely distributed in Western Ukraine in July 1941. One of the leaflets, often cited in the literature, leaflets instructs the reader, the reader, the first that I have here on the presentation, the readers that they should destroy their enemies and especially the Jews. In addition, the second less well-known document, Klimov introduced military revolutionary tribunals with the right to issue death penalties. And also, that is probably also important, collective responsibilities of families and nations for all offenses against the Ukrainian army and the Ukrainian state. These basically are the framework of orders that existed from the side of the leadership of the OUN at the beginning of the German-Soviet war. And that provides also the framework of actions of local and regional commanders of the OU. That means there did not exist any order to organize or begin pogroms, but there were several elements in this framework of orders that facilitated widespread anti-Jewish violence. But also on the German side, Jews were seen as the central group of supporters and beneficiaries of Bolshevism and Soviet rule. German civil and police officials, as well as army officers, expected and appreciated that after the German invasion, violent reckonings with the Soviet supporters, and especially, as they called it, Bolshevist Jewish oppressors and Soviet supporters, from the side of the local population will start. These expectations constituted the background for the often, also often cited, for the well-known and often cited cable that Reinhard Heydrich, the head of the Reichssicherheitshauptamt, the head of the German, most of the German police forces, sent to the commanders of the so-called Einsatzgruppen on the 29th of June 1941, where he ordered his police forces to support self-cleansing activities of anti-communist and anti-Jewish circles and to instigate programs. Sometimes this document is interpreted as a proof of a rather long-term German preparation and planning of programs, presumably in cooperation with local and among them Ukrainian nationalists. In fact, there's no further evidence for this, at least not for the Ukrainians. And also, the document itself, I think, seems to suggest rather the contrary. Yeah, he refers, Heydrich refers to a meeting on the 17th of June 1941 that took place with leaders of high-ranking police officials and leaders of the Einsatzgruppen, and here the question of pogroms clearly was one among many topics, and the existence of these this letter rather indicates a lack of concrete preparation. Heydrich sent it because he and most likely also Himmler believed that after 1 week after the beginning of the war, the Einsatzgruppen so far had put too less effort in instigating pogroms. Both this and as well as the fact that there existed deep mutual distrust between the only Ukrainian organization that was able to act in the Soviet occupied areas, the Bandera OUN, and the German institution that was assigned the task of instigating programs, the security police, is another argument that lets appear joint preparation rather unlikely. Yes, I will now come to the second part of my paper on the events after the 22nd of June 1941, and I would like to start with a discussion of events in the city of Lubov. The German troops entered the city in the early morning of the 30th of June 1941. They were greeted by enthusiastic inhabitants, as it happened more or less everywhere in Eastern Galicia. The prisons were among the buildings German troops moved to immediately after entering the city. Here they found a large number of murdered inmates, probably between 2,100 and 3,500 people. In the morning of that same day, immediately after the Germans had moved into the city, the OUN created a local militia from its underground fighters and from volunteers. At the same day, Bandera's deputy Yaroslav Stetsko arrived in the city, and he prepared the announcement of a Ukrainian state that took place at the evening of that day. And he instead declared the Ukrainian state, despite the fact that the German side had repeatedly forbidden him to do, or the OUN to do that. Nevertheless, the Germans afterwards proceeded only very cautiously against Stetsko and the OUN because there was no definite decisions at that time about the future status of the Ukrainian territories. And also because probably the Wehrmacht expected further support from the Ukrainians in their fight against the Red Army. However, some days later, on the 5th of July, Bandera was arrested in Krakow, and on 9th of July, Stetsko in Lvov. And some days later, also the German military intelligence, the Abwehr stopped its cooperation with the Bandera. In the afternoon of 13th of June 1941, the day when the German troops had entered the city, the German army commanders had ordered to retrieve the corpses from the cells of the prisons and from mass graves in the prisons in order to allow the population to search for the relatives among the dead. Presumably, the German local commander assigned the Ukrainian militia the task of providing workers for retrieving the body. This was one of the usual procedures of the German army to oblige Jews to all clearing and other works after it had occupied a certain locality. The number of Jews brought to the prisons in the afternoon of 30th of June was small, and no major acts of violence are reported for these hours. A much larger roundup of Jews started in the morning of 1st of July, and it seems to be probably, though there are no direct evidence, did the Einsatzgruppe 10 and the German security police, and that have meanwhile also arrived in the city, contributed to the fact that then a much larger number of Jews were brought to the prisons than the number of workers actually needed for retrieving the bodies of the murdered prison inmates. This roundup of Jews starting in the morning of the 1st of July of 1941 was the central context of the program violence that unfolded during that day. Members of the militia, the Ukrainian militia, or civilians who joined the militia in these activities took Jews from the streets or from their apartments and brought them to the prisons individually or in groups in much larger numbers than the number of workers actually needed for that work. This is another scene from the street in front of one of the prisons. Here, this is the number of Jews assembled in the prison at Ilitsa once here again. On the one hand, the acts of violence intended to punish with the Jews that group that in the eyes of many had supported and benefited from Soviet rule. On the other hand, the acts of violence performed also in a symbolic way the reversal of the social order and hierarchy of ethnic groups that allegedly had existed in the Soviet period. Thereby, in a way, the acts of violence also celebrated also the establishment of the new order of the Ukrainian nation state. But the violence resulted clearly also from the hatred of Soviet rule that increased by the confrontation with the corpses in the prison. Many of the decomposing corpses looked horrifying. Rumors spread quickly that the inmates had been tortured to death and their bodies had been mutilated. Some of these rumors showed pictures of older Christian legends, among them blood libel against Jews. The most widespread rumor that existed in a number of different versions and later was also reported from other cities was about priests who had been crucified in the prisons and in other gruesome ways mutilated, as well as rumors about children nailed to the walls in the prison. In fact, nearly all prisoners in the in most other cities and other prisons in Eastern Galicia had been killed by shots in the necks. the rumors about these mutilations and about these things, as in detailed analysis of the sources shows, are pure products of fantasies. Nothing or nearly nothing of such atrocities actually happened during the killing of the prison inmate was a horrible act, but the prisoners were not tortured during that act. For the most part, the violence in the streets on the 1st of July 1941 ended in the afternoon when, according to several Jewish witnesses from the prisons, German officers appeared and ordered to release the Jews who had brought them. It is impossible to establish an exact number of Jews killed during the 1st of July in Lvov, but there can be no doubt that the number of 4,000 or sometimes even 7,000 that are mentioned in the literature is much too high. The existence of reports about the concrete acts of probably a group of Jews killed in the Brigitte prison, most of them are probably have been shot by German forces. There was also, So the next point. The number of 4,000 victims for the Lvov is probably much too high. Nevertheless, that number of 4,000 victims of the program is the number of memoirs of surviving Jews. Apparently, that is a number that spread as a rumor during that time in the city. And as a number of Jews killed in Lvov during the whole of July 1941, it is probably roughly two. Except for the several hundred victims of the pogrom of 1st of July, about 2,000 Jews were shot on the 5th of July by the German police forces, the Einsatzgruppe, that was declared as a reprisal for the Soviet massacre of prison inmates, and a further about 1,500 Jews were shot during the so-called Petliura days of the 25th and 5th and 26th of July. And the Petliura days in many features resembled very much the mass execution of the 5th of July 1941 and not the pogrom of the 1st of July. Yes, and in the abridged third part of my paper, I would like to present some results of the analysis of anti-Jewish violence in a number of other localities. Here three major contexts can be distinguished. The first context is the retrieval of murdered prison inmates, like in Lvov. This was the things were to a high degree similar. The Jews were brought in order to retrieve the bodies of the murdered inmates, and acts of violence occurred during this procedure. But there are considerable differences, and the differences you see here in Spree and Stanislavov suggests that the attitude of the local authorities are very significant. In Spree, probably Jews were not forced to retrieve the bodies of the murdered prison inmates. There was, had been taking place a really large Soviet massacre in Spree. In Stanislavov, there Jews had to retrieve the bodies, but the town, whereas the southeastern part of Galicia was occupied by Hungarian troops, and they usually prevented, where there were present, larger acts of violence against Jews. So these events also here for this part are very different. Another context is the executions and punishments of enemies by OUN, Bandera OUN militias, or combat units. But also this could take very, very different forms and contexts. They also killed and executed sometimes Ukrainian supporters of Soviet rule. They also sometimes Poles. And the feature of these acts of violence here is that in the case of Ukrainians, and in most cases also for Poles, only men or people who had actually some connection with Soviet rule were executed, while in the Jewish case, so all families were killed. And these sometimes apparently became a kind of excess, transformed in a kind of excessive violence, where then attempts were made to kill the whole Jewish population of certain smaller localities. The third context is the violent excesses of German military and police forces, primarily excesses of the Waffen-SS unit, the Waffen-SS division Viking, that was responsible for those pogroms, that was responsible for those pogroms that claimed the largest numbers of victims. This unit belonged to the combat troops, that it was subordinated to the army. It was not a part of the police forces and had no police tasks. Parts of Viking had a central role in the violent excesses in Swatchowskoe, these places that I have there, Yerzhana, Jemarovskaya, and Panopoli. In all these places, also local militias of the UN and inhabitants participated in the violence, but the large number of victims clearly is the result of the involvement of the Waffen-SS. The Waffen-SS units come through the cities and towns in search of Jewish men and shot them where they found them, like as a Jewish survivor described it, like on a hunting expedition. While the death toll through pogroms violence in most cities is below 1% of the Jewish population, as for example in Lviv, it did really exceed 3%, like for example in Boleslav. In these places it was among 8 and 30% of the Jewish population. Yes, I have then in summarizing, I think it's possible to distinguish three major motifs or motivations for violence from the side of the local or primarily Ukrainian population. One is the view as of Jews as supporters and beneficiaries of Soviet rule. That was also the basis of seeing them as sharing the guilt for the murder of the prison inmates. The second motif is a national one. For the UN, the Jews were also an undesired group for the future Ukrainian nation state that they wanted to establish, and that is also, I believe, a motif for their continuing cooperation with the Germans also after the arrest of von Dera and Stetzko in the rest of July and also still in part of August. And the third motivation is also, there's also a religious element, I believe, in this violence from the part of the local population. The paper I have addressed this only shortly, but the rumors about Soviet atrocities that were loaded with Christian motifs and show that the end of the Soviet rule was also a period of religious excitement and exaltation. In a way, traditional images and folk cultures of Jews as representatives of evil and the embodiment of the aliens, of the alien threatening world of evil certainly played also a role here. Finally, a comparison of the number of victims, in different places show that the image of Ukrainians as, so to speak, in a way parodic pogromists needs also some correction here for the summer of 1941. As I mentioned above, the number of deaths often is difficult to establish, and there were certainly many incidents in villages we don't have information on, but number of victims that we have documents on can be established at about 7,700 to 11,000 Jews killed during these first weeks of July 1941. This is my conclusion here, somewhat less than what that exists in the literature, that is about 15,000 or even more. However, I believe that the fact is no less important, that about 60% of the deaths were victims of pogroms where the Waffen-SS Division Viking had a central role. Nevertheless, from the local side, at the core of all cases of deadly violence that I could examine more closely, there were clearly groups of the Bandera UN. Despite the fact that often other inhabitants joined them spontaneously, this also sheds some doubt on images of peasants coming into the towns in order to plunder and to kill Jews that also sometimes can be found in Jewish memoirs. In fact, peasants that came during these weeks into towns after they had been occupied by German troops or the Soviets had left, came either in search for goods from Soviet warehouses or primarily as organized units of the OUN in order to establish the Ukrainian nation state and to establish a Ukrainian administration in the cities. Thank you very much.